coalition for ethnic and social equity school. And we started it about maybe 6 months ago. Last year in July, there was a similar a law that passed in Oregon that was bringing ethnic studies, and Vermont should be the second state. So I called in all these amazing people that are already doing a lot of work in the state of Vermont, that are already working with schools, working within their communities, and I said, let's do this. So what is an organic, really organic coalition is led by people of color. We have people from all the, what we call ethnic and social groups, so people from the LGBTIQ community, people from the disability rights community, that are really coming together and saying, enough. We need to make some changes. 20 years ago, there was a study that was done in all the Vermont schools that found that there was, in the words of the study, pervasive racism in all Vermont schools. Then 3 years later, they did a follow-up study that said, well, Vermont still has pervasive racism in all the schools. This was 20 years ago. We know from firsthand, because we are the communities of color, that the report is talking about that things still have not changed. And this coalition was formed to pass this legislation. It's, and Kaya and everybody can talk a little more about it, but in essence, it's to begin the first very small step to look at the standards that are in all the schools from pre-K through 12th grade and say, okay, where there's a bias? And when are we gonna start talking about the histories that we represent? So that our kids that are in schools now and in the future see themselves represented. We know that it is not just for the kids of color or kids from the social groups, but it is for everybody. When you see and you can take pride of people that are making change, and also feel proud of other people making change, that we start to create the change together. And that we can see our peers as the humanity within ourselves. I, as an immigrant, came and never really see, still with my English language problems, but really saw role models in those textbooks that didn't represent me. So my sense of identity didn't get developed until I went to college and started reading teachers of color, writers that were really hitting home in my heart. And this bill is for our kids in the future, and the way we're gonna create this format is we have these amazing panelists that are part of the coalition, and we're going to let you also tell us why ethnic studies and why this is so important. So I'll start with Sanika.
Does anyone who's come from really far want to go first? I just want to honor the people who've traveled from other parts of the state.
I'm staying in Stowe, so.
This is a grassroots initiative that's coming out of the communities. It's something that when we came together the first time, that activists from all over the state, we were able to agree on this so easily. It was such an intuitively correct idea to work towards having ethnic and social equity standards in the schools. And as we've reached out across the state, the educators, students, parents, people working in administration and state government, everyone, there's been a lot of response like, oh, thank you. Like, everyone's looking for a way to solve some of these problems. And what I'm really excited about with this initiative is that it's really positive and transformative. It's not really against anything. It's just for bringing in some of the truth about the history of this country and all the different groups that have come together to make it what it is. And another thing that I'm excited about as like a racial justice nerd is that when we talk about breaking down racism, we talk about working at the internal level, the interpersonal level, the organizational level, and at the systemic level. And I really think that when we start teaching students from a very young age an inclusive curriculum and everything, that we're actually working on all of those four levels. So it could be really effective as a sort of strategy for countering structural racism. And also, Vesta 57 centers our children and prioritizes teaching them about the contributions of all groups. And this is going to help us address existing bias in the curriculum, which is something that many parents of color and LGBTQIA community parents have noticed, that there's a lot of intrinsic bias that you can find in American history and other curricula. And what we hope to do is to teach the children to honor and love themselves in all of their differences and diversity, and to honor and love each other. So what's beautiful about this work is that it's about lifting everyone up, and particularly the groups that have been pushed down. And we're hoping that Vermont can again be a leader in issues of civil and human rights recognition.
I was one of those people who were at the meeting 20 years ago when we introduced I look at this as an emerging process. I come here as a parent. I've been living in Vermont. I come here as a parent and as an educator and as a community organizer. My child first experience around color was when he came home and said, "Mom, they did enslave me," and he listed all of these names. And he was learning about the Civil War. It's the first time in his academic career that people of color were introduced. The African American Alliance of the Northeast Kingdom started first to support parents, to advocate for parents, to recognize that we needed to get into the schools because there wasn't anything happening in these schools. There were sporadic efforts around the state. VARA, Vermont Anti-Racism Action Team, was started around 20 years ago, again, to meet that need. And we would, it's almost like triage, you would come in, you would talk to the parents, you talk to the school, but once it got past that of what was needed, doors closed, nothing happened. I come here emotionally because I'm on my second generation. I'm on my second generation where my grandson is not going to get on the school bus because of what's happening in school. I listen to my grandson over the phone. I listened to him read the last chapter and a half of The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. The great thing about that was we didn't have FaceTime. So he didn't have to see what I went through. I asked him how did he feel about that particular word. Well, he got the story. He got the moral piece excellently. And I asked him how did he appreciate that word. And his response was a demonstration of years of how do I get by. Vermont has had efforts in the past, and some of them are now coming into review that they were not great. I was part of those efforts. I received those trainings. Again, it was led by white people. People of color were not able to be at that table. We were at the table, we didn't have the power, we didn't have the voice. I read to children, and I try to bring as much cultural diversity as possible. It's the teachers and the aides that are uncomfortable. We are working, I'm working with a group in the St. Johnsbury School, and how do we support communities of color? Looking at how do you create, develop a fundamental foundational language, promoting racial literacy, acknowledging the situation as is. The other day, a young boy in Danville was singing a song in Spanish. Another boy told him to stop singing because it had swear words. It was Spanish. I asked him what swear words and how did he know, and he said he had the B word. I didn't know the translation, but I asked him some pertinent questions. I have the translation. I would say the words are probably not appropriate for a second grader to sing, but there are no swear words. The almost feminist way the student said in Spanish made me realize more than ever, this is so crucial that we pass this bill, that we emerge is my new word, that we emerge and become a leader, that we have the capacity.
Now, obviously, there's a few things wrong with this, but let's focus on her. This young woman, who loved and respected and trusted me, was utterly afraid to even see people who looked different than her. No one spoke to her, no one accosted her, no one did anything at all except exist. And that was too much for her. Between lack of exposure in her life and lack of exposure in her education, this young woman could not even see someone different without being afraid. And this example is not unique. Now, I don't think we're going to solve the problem of the lack of people of color overnight, and yes, that is a problem. There are so many broken systems to repair that particular endeavor will take far more time for large numbers of people of color even consider coming to our state as an option. But there is something we can do right now to help to repair the gaps in our education system, and that's to support this legislation. There's a quote that I love by Adrian Rich that goes, "When those who have the power to name and to socially construct reality choose not to see or hear you. When someone with the authority of a teacher, say, describes the world and you are not in it, there is a moment of psychic disequilibrium as though you looked into a mirror and saw nothing. It takes some strength of soul, and not just individual strength, but collective understanding to resist this void, this non-being into which you are thrust, and to stand up demanding to be seen and heard. Vermont, we can do better. We must do better. Students of color are facing the same exact struggle to be reflected in their communities as I did when I left here in 1996. That is unacceptable. White students are still afraid of people of color, even though because of technology, our world is shrinking, and they have more access than ever to different cultures and colors and people and ways of knowing and learning than ever before. If we are to be a successful people, we must be a well-educated people, and that education must be founded in the principle of equity. Equity in treatment for students, equity in curriculum, and equity in representation at every level of our education system. I want to thank you for being here tonight, and I want to thank Amanda and Kai for your passion and brilliance and dedication to making this piece of legislation a possibility, and for demanding that all students and people and all people who make contributions to our world are seen, heard, and valued.
Thank you, everybody. I didn't do good homework, but frankly, it's bad. My name is Wafiq Faul. I'm Palestinian American Muslim. I'm a member of Vermont for Justice in Palestine and member of this coalition. Great coalition. When Amanda started this work, definitely I felt a personal commitment to this. The reason is I am a father of two children, Candy and Zane, and both, mainly my daughter, faced a bullying in school when she told her class after writing a paper that she is a Palestinian Arab and Muslim. This bullying continued, forced me even to pull her out from our public school, and me and her mother are pro-public school. So I pulled her from Camelham Middle School and to a private school. It is sad, 50 years later after the movement on University of California in San Francisco and Cornell University, where people insisted on Black and Latin study on the school, that we come here in Vermont to talk about this subject. For the people who are sitting here, if you think what you study in your school was the truth that was representative, what is America now? This bill is not for you. For the people who believe that the ethnic groups who are in less than 20 years going to be majority of this great nation, this bill will correct the problem. Always I will give example about this bill, about Vermont 50, 60 years ago when the trash was all over the state and Greenup Vermont stopped to get rid of this trash, to get rid of racism and discrimination. We have to start somewhere. So we need your help now. Kaya needs your help now. That to call our representatives, our senators, and we start the hard work. That this bill, we needed to pass this legislation this time. And and not to push it more. Thank you for it.
Just wait 1 second and just reflect a little bit, and we want to, so that we're not all talking, maybe open it up for you to either give your testimony or make a comment, and then we'll go back to the panelists. And I want to emphasize that this is a collective effort. This coalition is really, it was in my work, it really was a collective effort everybody has made. So I've done so much work for you. Samara, would you like to say
okay.
Rachel, you want to say so does anybody wanna come up and say something? Or if not, we can just have the panelists continue to talk, but okay, we'll have the panelists continue.
Good evening. My name is Victoria Pearson, and I'm a member of Central Vermont Showing Up for Racial Justice. And we're a group of white folks working with other white folks to help us skill up to be able to do multiracial organizing and build racial justice in our communities. I mean, you. And you're welcome. Right. I also live on some land in East Montpelier in a community called Openway Farm. And I'm here with my family tonight. I think I was asked to speak as a parent of two white children, Forrest and Fern. I think we were out in the garden, and I was talking to Forrest about this, and I said, hey, Forrest, do you think it's a good idea for me to come and talk about you know, how education should talk more than just about white people, and how we should try to end racism in our schools and have more stories and more truth in our schools. And he said, yeah, that's a great idea. And I said, like, well, do you think I should, you know, do you want to say something? He's like, no, I don't want to say something, but I'll be there. And so I'm like looking at you, and you're being here and supporting me and saying this stuff. So, I mean, I think for me, I just want to just talk about what the bill means to me and what it means to my family. This bill means to me that for the first time, people of color in the state will have a substantive say in how education will reflect their lives and experience. It means that the complexity of the world will not be called marginal or special or a separate thing, but will be brought to the center of our educational standards. It means that I, as a queer woman, will have some hope that the complexity of love that I feel, the complexity of family that I know, there may be some hope of that being represented, invisible, in my children's education. Not just mine, but for everybody. And when I think about what does this mean for my family, I really feel like this means that my children's education will not be under this false narrative of white supremacy. And to come out from under that false narrative of white supremacy of Eurocentric education is an incredible gift for my white children. It's an incredible gift because it helps to dissolve the illusions and make it possible for them to maybe take their correct place in this large tapestry of our society. So really, like, removing this illusion that some cultures are elevated and others are demeaned. And I think, too, it means that my children will learn, and all of our children will learn, that the truth and power of our survival and thriving through much adversity and injustice is like that, they'll learn about that, they'll actually see that. So the complexity of the truth of the injustices of white supremacy and enslavement and all of it, that truth will elevate us all, because it will show actually how we have survived and thrived through that. So that's all I got. Thank you very much.
I'm one of the liaisons for the LGBTQIA Alliance of Vermont, and yes, that just keeps getting bigger.
as every community comes forward with language defining who they are, it's my responsibility to use it. Because if I'm not reflecting my community back to them, they're not being included. On March 15th of this year, there was an LGBTQIA youth day that was sponsored here at the State House. I remember the first leadership day that was sponsored here. It was nothing like this year. There were 65 youth who came from statewide. They testified before committees. They got a standing ovation on the World House. I also want to share with you their voices from that day. They spoke with Kaya and thanked her for this piece of legislation. They spoke to the governor, and they held his feet to the fire. They spoke to the out legislators, and they spoke to me. One of the things that they strongly said was that they don't see themselves reflected back in the curriculum in their schools. They're not there. That if there is any conversation about sexual orientation or gender identity, it happens in a healthcare curriculum, and I'm about to make a very offensive statement, that is taught by a well-meaning straight white woman who has absolutely no training or experience with the LGBTQIA communities. So what they do is they go out to the internet to look for resources and support. Let me tell you the concerns I have about my kids going out onto the internet to find resources where they don't know where they exist, typing in the word sexual orientation and who is just waiting there to answer. One of the things that came out recently was a study from New York City University. And it was about the LGBTQ communities in poverty, and it was a very strong statement about schools and education. And what this study said is that what our youth need is curriculum that is written by the community, for the community, and is taught by people who are trained on those issues, or more importantly, who can identify as LGBTQIA and can serve as an adult role model. As a kid who grew up here in Vermont, and I'll tell you, it was in Plainfield, which is like 10 miles away, I kept waiting for the person in the front of the room to use the language that said they knew that I might be part of their class, that I belong in their community. And this, which is a very short story, and this is a personal experience. You can imagine my feelings when I woke up after the 2016 election, and then I saw the cabinet that was being created, and they would have liked you much more than they would have liked me. And I love you. And I looked at, you know, okay, so what are we doing here in Vermont to ensure that we keep all of those protections we would put in place? Is this still my life? So I came to Paul Scott's inauguration. And I went through the line just to congratulate him, to say thank you for using the language actually in the speech that did reaffirm I was part of the community here. I was truly a Vermonter. I truly did belong. But the most interesting thing that happened is I was standing in line waiting to congratulate the governor. I could see his security detail looking at me. And sort of with this inquisitive look, and I'm like, okay, you know. And as I got closer, the officer leaned into me and said, the pink triangle, does it have meaning? And I looked at him and said, this is what the Nazis put on gay men when they were interned during the Holocaust. And I will remember his response. He looked at me and said, why didn't I know that? Exactly.
Bennington.
So the other end of the state. This has been quite an emotional journey. And even hearing the stories of folks that are here tonight, it's very emotional for a lot of reasons. It's not just what we're on the precipice of trying to make happen, to actualize, but it's also based on lived experience from what's happened throughout my childhood and in trying to build a better future for all children, including my own. The promise of this bill goes far beyond just what's within the textbooks. It is asking for a level of community engagement and expertise that we have not seen in quite some time to ensure that what we're going to come out with in the end is something that is relevant, something that is meaningful, and something that is impactful. That we are asking for our schools to do more than just have an awareness month or to cover this in one particular chapter, but we're saying, what are you doing within your school culture to change the conversation and make sure that all of our youth whom we're trusting, we send our babies off to school and they are there for the majority of our day, and we want to know that they come back whole and that they are not traumatized, that they are not indoctrinated with information that's going to lead them to misunderstand the world that they live in, that's going to make them feel inadequate in any way, shape, or form about their own lived experiences and what they know and what they've seen. And that they know that they're safe, because that is a requirement, that when we have our schools, that they feel safe. My son, when he was 3, I'll never forget this. It was one of those critical moments, and we talk about this because this is not just something that happens in middle school or in high school or even just elementary school. I'm talking preschool. And my son's preschool that he was at, and there were only 2 children who are not white in that whole class, my son and one other little boy. We'll call him Jack. Jack had been having a really hard time in this classroom, and there were some students, one in particular, who was she was a bit of a bully. She was allowed to do what she wanted to do and create social circles within that classroom that she wanted, and the teachers kind of indulged her in this process. And I walked in with my son, who had been regressing in his development, had become anxious and afraid to go to school, and didn't know why until I watched this little boy try to play with other kids in the class. They were all doing a puzzle, and he wanted to join in, and this little girl said, "No, you can't, Jack. Go away." And this child started chanting, "Jack, go away. Jack, go away. Jack, go away." And the other kids joined in. And the teacher did nothing. And so then Jack kicked the puzzle, as a 3-year-old would. How else do they express their emotions when they're being harmed in such a way? And the teacher's response was, "Well, if you do things like that, Jack, that's why the kids don't want to play with them." And so to remedy this, I had to call the director, and I called all the parents. You know, we went old school. I called every mom. Everybody's mom. I let them know what happened in the class so that they could have that conversation with their children. But that conversation wasn't happening in the classroom, so we're supposed to somehow double down and make up for what's missing in the other parts of their life when we're trusting our children to be in these spaces for so much of their day. So this bill, to me, gives not only the promise of bringing about equity and real voices and real stories, but it also is a chance to really transform our educational system and to ask for a level of accountability as to whether or not we're actually delivering on that duty of care for our next generations so that we can create a society that is anti-racist, anti-bigoted. That's the only way that we're going to do this. So I'm so grateful that this coalition came together, brought this forth, that we fought, that we've negotiated, that we've worked so hard to get it here, and we're going to finish this with all of you. So I thank you for being here.
Before we go on, I need to extend an apology to Kyle. I made a joke that was based on white privilege, saying that the current administration would be more willing to see her than me. That was decidedly white privilege. I should not have diminished the impact of the racist statement of the current administration. I truly apologize to you.
That's how it's done.
Experiences that reflected my own. And Martin Luther King and Rosa Parks does not meet the bare minimum. And it just doesn't. It doesn't. And the way that we even do talk about oppression of people of color, it's we just gloss over it, and it's not detailed, it's not even accurate, and it's not the whole picture, and it's very victim blaming, and they belittle our experiences. And I want to make it very clear that you cannot become what you don't already know is possible. So if you never see yourself reflected in society, if you never see anyone that looks like yourself, if you're never told that you can become a teacher, a doctor, an attorney, a scientist, then you just won't aspire to do so. And I feel like if I was actually able to learn about myself, to learn about the experiences of people of color, not just negative experiences, because we have a plethora of experiences that are valuable and worth offering up to our curriculum, then maybe I would have viewed myself differently. Maybe I wouldn't have gone through this entire process of self-growth, which I can speak on the better half of the people of color that I have met throughout my life that grew up in Vermont schools, that they had to endure this process of self-hatred and then unpack that trauma when they were either in high school or out of high school, or they're still doing it as adults. And that is an experience that we robbed of them. And people don't understand that internalized oppression, it takes a toll on your self-esteem, your self-worth. It takes a toll on what you even think is possible, what you think you can actually do as a human being, what you can produce as a human being. And going through school and thinking that you're ugly, that you don't deserve to be there, that you're worthless, that that everyone that looks like you is not, doesn't belong there, that doesn't have a right to be there, doesn't have a right to speak. We really have robbed students of color from their education. It's not an equal access thing. We don't have equal access to our education because half the time we're fighting to, for our own humanity. Half the time we're just reaffirming that we actually belong to be in that space in the first place. We're defending ourselves against bigotry. We have to stand up with no one behind us protecting us or defending us or even acknowledging that there's a problem in the first place. And it's like, if I'm spending the majority of my education educating other people, then what am I getting in return? How do I benefit? And I don't know, looking on the other side, which is only a couple of days, because like I said, I'm just it's really been a surreal process. And to look at myself from before when I would straighten my hair every day, I would look in the mirror and I would cry every single day and feel disgusting and worthless and inferior in comparison to my friends, when I thought that I couldn't raise my hand in class because I thought that nothing I would say had
would make a difference or would matter to anyone. When I had to look at my friends and tell them that they were beautiful, that they had a right to be there, that they were valuable, and that they were capable of greatness. It's like when we only go into school and we see white faces and male faces, and none that reflect our own, it takes a toll on who you are. And then I watch my little brother and how he struggles with self-esteem and struggles to it's like I'm just watching it happen again, and there's nothing I can do. And it's just not. We shouldn't have to first hate ourselves to learn to love ourselves. We shouldn't have to endure all this to realize that we actually belong there and that we deserve to become something, that we actually are going to go somewhere, that we actually can go to college, that we actually can graduate from high school. So this bill is so important to me because I never thought that this would be possible. I never thought that anyone would care, that anyone would actually stand up and defend us. Because I spent my entire childhood defending myself and against my teachers, against other students, and against the administration, having them justify their actions, making excuses for their actions, and then centering themselves around what was happening to me, making my problems, the things I was facing about them, and then forgetting me somewhere in the process, and nothing would ever happen, nothing. I've been called the N-word by my own teachers. I don't even want to go into detail, but it's like just the level of ignorance and the level of, it amazes me how proudly people do these things and how they just can live their lives and go on like it never happened, but really it's taken a toll on everything and how I feel about myself. And so I feel like it starts with education. And like I said before, like you cannot become what you don't already know is possible. So if you never see that, if you never see yourself, and it's not just school, like you have to understand that when we go home and we turn on the television, all we see is white faces and white experiences. We are taught to value Eurocentric accomplishments, Eurocentric contributions, Eurocentric beauty, Eurocentric everything. We are nowhere in this picture. Like everywhere we go, even in our own families, in our own homes, that like we're surrounded by people of color, or our own communities that we've like created for ourselves to protect ourselves, like these safe spaces, it's like whiteness still seeps in everywhere we go. Like there's nowhere in society that you will not see whiteness reflected. The band-aids that you buy, the dolls that you have available for your children to buy, the books that you have available in your library to give to your kids to read, like we're invisible. And that's why it's important for us to actually value ethnic studies and to value this history, because it shows you that you actually care about educating your students of color. It actually shows that you care about us and that you see us in your classrooms and that you want to have us feel heard, that you want to like actually include us, and you make the time and the space to do so. And I feel like this will not solve problems of internalized racism. This will not solve just the self-hatred that is abundant amongst young kids of color. But it is a chance for us to end it, because we can actually, for the first time in our lives, see ourselves. Like, people don't understand how important representation is until they don't have it. Imagine going through your entire life never seeing yourself anywhere in society. It makes you feel invisible, and it makes you feel like you do not belong to be there. And it's like, and the last thing I want to say is that there is no American history without our history. There is no American history. And so we're also holding back the white students in our classes, because this whole world of experiences, lived history, that they don't even know anything about, and they walk through this world so blind to all of it because we keep that opportunity away from them. And please consider that when considering our experiences too. It's like they walk through this world so blindly, and that holds them back. That holds them back from becoming an ally, from actually lending a helping hand, from actually stopping this cycle. And it just limits their understanding of one another and the world in general. Like everything, if everything is centered around you and about you, then how can you see anyone else? So they're just, our history classes don't make any sense. Like there is no America without us. It's just not, it wouldn't have been possible. You needed us to create it. So why don't we actually pay where it's due and represent us? Like, yeah.
Looks at the policies, and then create
give to the state board for them to sign it off. And that's gonna, that will be our next fight once for the state board to say, okay, we're gonna adopt this. so they're ready to follow it. But that's what it does. It's 257, so the action right now is to call the Senate Education Committee and say, this is important to us, we're gonna do it. And then call your representative and say, this bill will be, and you need to support it because it's important. Okay, so now I wanna leave it up for questions, and Representative Gonzalez also.
Well, speaking of calling representatives, I just wanted to highlight the representatives that we have in the room here today. And so if we can introduce ourselves, those of us who are representatives, I don't see any senators, but I'm Deanna Gonzalez, and I represent Winooski. So other representatives, please introduce yourselves.
Charlie Kimball, I represent Woodstock.
Selena Colburn, I represent Burlington.
Carol Cody, I represent the Farmer North End of Burlington.
Kimberly Joseph, I represent Middlesex and East Montpelier.
And I know Barbara Richardson was here earlier, and she represents Burlington. And so I wanted to take a moment to have us acknowledge ourselves, those of us that are representatives, because although you all are not having a hearing in front of a committee, you are being heard, and so wanting you all to know that collectively, and that that we're here to hear from you all how important this is, and now that you can connect faces to names, if you haven't already reached out to us, we are interested and we are here for that, so please keep our names and faces in mind when you are thinking about your advocacy and how we might be able to assist.
Thank you so much. Partners too. We have organizations like Voices, who's here, ACLU, and all the steering committee. You can look at our website. We have all the organizations that are involved in this effort. So keep them in mind. Migrant Justice. My memory is not very good, so I will maybe write them down and say them later. But when I open the floor,
yeah, I have a question. Mostly clarifying, and also thank you all so much. Unbelievable what you were saying, and I can tell you I have some knowledge of what you went through, having raised two adopted African American children in Vermont. So I went through a lot of schools. My question is, when is this? What's the time frame on this? When do we need to get to this? I mean, do we need to call our legislator immediately, or?
Yes. Yeah. So it's do you want to tell us?
So again, the bill is actually in, because it's a miscellaneous education bill, there's a lot of components to it, including this. So it's right now under review and appropriations, but I believe that they'll be getting that out fairly shortly. So, but we're winding down on the session anyway, so any words of encouragement are greatly appreciated to be able to make sure that they get a chance to hear from you.
Yeah, so we're having in the next couple of weeks, so tomorrow, make the calls to the Senate Education Committee. They want to hear from us and call your representatives. So anybody wants to share?
I want to say thank you. It's long overdue. I was lucky enough to grow up in a very rich, diverse area of New Jersey, and then moved to upstate Connecticut, very, very white, a ghetto. And so I had to take my five little white kids to New York to see there were other people in the world. And Vermont, I love. Vermont needs you, and I'm so glad we're finally moving forward with an attempt at better school teaching, more diversity, and I'm all with you. Good luck.
Share a quick story. When the lieutenant governor showed the injustice that the curriculum in our schools is so Eurocentric, telling the story from a white perspective with little to no mention of the huge history of resistance, the huge history of contribution of people from so many other groups than white groups. And the third point I wanted to make was, Shauna, you mentioned about how long people have been working on trying to get things in the curriculum. You for decades. And if it was easy, if the agency of education, if teachers would just say, oh, okay, yeah, let's do that. But it's been tried and tried and tried. And things are shifting, they're emerging, they're moving, and every angle that we can get to move people faster, more comprehensively, to recognize the urgency that we have, we've got to take. Because as you, Zamora, so eloquently spoke about your personal experience, your personal harm, which I think is such a grave injustice that so many Vermont children are experiencing this, that it's just not okay. It's a huge injustice, and we need to deal with it from every angle possible. So thank you, representatives and senators, for your leadership, for you folks, for working on it, because we need to get on this. Thank you.
Thank you. So this doesn't move. We have been able to bring everybody together. So it's not just a Association but with disability rights movement, the LGBTIQ. Because we think that an injustice to one is an injustice to all. And that we need to work together to ensure that our voices and the needs of the whole community are listened to. So this is what we don't have. Tom, who was from the Vermont Independent Living.
Vermont Center for Independent Living.
Thank you. We're supposed to be here, but couldn't. Oh, actually, no, they weren't supposed to be here. They couldn't come. So,
Thank you. That's great. My name is Carolyn Wesley. I live in Montpelier. First, I want to say I think this bill is such a great example of how when you design policy with the lived experience of people who have been historically at the margins and historically disadvantaged, and with the leadership of people from those communities, you design policy that is better for everyone. And I think that people on the panel spoke to that really well. And as a white person who grew up in the Vermont school system, a lot of the stories shared about the impact of our current school system on white children really resonated. And the only thing that I want to add is that I am one of those elusive people who grew up here and went away to school and to work and then came back and want to stay here and want to raise a family here. And right now, people seem to be very interested in who those people are and how we get them and how we get people back. But my biggest fear about that choice, there's so much I love about Vermont and so much I love about coming back, is what that will mean for my kids. When I now having a better understanding of how growing up in this homogenous community really hurt me, that I don't want my kids to have that same experience. I want their humanity to be full. I don't want their humanity to be shared with everyone around them. And so I think the point about, yes, we need this in our curriculum, we also need more diverse people in the state. And this is like an economic development and a population initiative. Like, for, yes, it's mostly, like, first and foremost, it's about honoring the humanity of people, and we shouldn't try to sell it as something other than that. But some people like other reasons to support bills. And if we get this right in our school system, people are going to want to come and bring their kids here. And young people, particularly in this country, the demographics are, our families are going to be more and more diverse. So if we do this right, we're moving toward that future prosperous Vermont that folks seem so interested in.
So thank you for mentioning economics, and Zamora, you mentioned too the idea that it's time for us to get paid now. I feel like if I leave here tonight without knowing this piece within the legislation, I would not be doing my full duty as one of the racial justice warriors of our state. The folks that will be coming to the table, the Agency of Education, will be there getting paid, right? Mm-hmm. Right. Who else is standing out there that's getting paid?
So everybody comes from agencies
right. That
already do this work. Right. So Curriculum Association, School Board Association.
They're all getting paid to do it. The people of color might receive, if we're lucky, a small stipend to come. So I want to make sure that we're acknowledging that this is progress, but it's still at the expense of the people who are marginalized. So I just want to make sure that we're recognizing that we are once again being called to the table to do the work that the white people couldn't do, and we're not getting paid for it. Just have to say that.
Thank you. And I want to say, you know, it was a point of contention. For us, because some of the steering committee members really want it. To make sure, and some of us felt that the bill will get
vetoed.
That we will not move if we put the money in. So we had a lot of discussions. We actually were supposed to put the money in, but that conversation happened after the bill was already introduced, and then we had so much negotiation that the money was left till the end, and then we didn't make it. So it has the stipends, but it's like $50. And mileage reimbursement, so we
if
want.
If you have insurance.
If
I may comment on this one,
yes.
Because it is very important. Yes. Understand that this bill is grossly underfunded.
Mm-hmm.
I'm grateful very much.
much for the Agency of Education trying to develop mechanisms to try to bring down the costs on this, but we really need to do this, to do it well. It needs funding. And so I know that that's a difficult battle right now. But I also want to, if you're going to make phone calls and emails to people, reach out to your federal delegates, because they've all been presented with this very bill. In particular, hit up Senator Lee. Just a little pro tip. They've all been asked to try to see if there are any, I mean, this is crucial for our state. It is absolutely crucial for our state. And if we can't get the support within the building, we need to build public-private partnerships. We need to look for wherever we can. So as well as you represent different organizations, entities, educational institutions that might have an interest in investing in this type of work, that money would be greatly appreciated. Thank you.
All right, if you have money, you want to pay them. That's fine.
Could you just say the bill number once more and what committee we're supposed to write to the Senate?
Yes. So it's now the S-257, and then you can mention the Ethnic Studies Bill. Okay. And it's, you will call on the Senate Education Committee.
Thank you.
And then your representative.
I am Stephanie Seguino from Burlington. I teach economics at UVM. And I have a question for you, and that is, what is the opposition you've run into? What are the arguments that you've heard from people as to why they might not support this? And if I could just make a couple of other comments. I was recently on the school board with Liz, and one of our greatest challenges has been hiring more teachers of color, not because of a lack of teachers of color, but because white hiring committees typically don't do what needs to be done. And so I think insofar as this passes, it's going to run up against that issue, and I will provide some useful pressure to change hiring practices. And I want to just, if I could just offer you a hopeful note. A couple of years ago, I developed a course at UVM called the Political Economy of Race, which deals with these issues in great detail. And my initial reaction to teaching the course was that my students were absolutely devoid of any instruction and knowledge of these issues in high school. And I've been thinking about that for the last several months, so I'm so pleased to see this. The other thing I want to share with you is that white kids in particular have such huge discomfort in talking about race. And what I saw were transformed students by the end of the semester. And it gives me great hope that when kids are actually confronted with knowledge, that this will actually be a transformative experience. And if this happens, especially in pre-K through 12, that it'll be an important role for the change that really needs to happen. So it means some great stuff.
Okay. Yes, of course.
Hi, Stephanie. Thanks. Thanks for bringing up about teachers. This really lends a larger issue. We have had teachers of color who come to the state and they don't stay. Teachers as well as other workers. And I'm so glad that you mentioned about the initiative of bringing people back. Who are they bringing back? Because many people who have grown up in Vermont of color don't want to see it ever again. So when we're looking at this, what are our communities doing to truly welcome and ensure people leave? I am so disheartened because we have had some well-established people who've come here and have given their energies and efforts. Some have moved on for professional reasons, others have moved on for their mental health, for their stress. Part of, I'm also with I Am Vermont too, and part of what we're doing is to make people of color visible. It's one thing to be visible, but if you're not embraced by your community on every single level, and schools are the heart of our community. Schools are what touches people in the pocketbook, in their values, It is the fruits of their labor. And if families do not feel welcome, secure, and embraced, I don't want to be tolerated, I want to be held on high. This is the challenge of the 95%. So when you lead, that's in supporting the bill, that's excellent. But that's only one piece of the puzzle, because we will have what I call, this is the hamster. We're rotating, we're putting a lot of efforts in, but to have me looking at another generation and continuing, the only thing that has changed are the names.
The worst thing we are facing when we talk about this bill in general, it is the best thing about Vermont. What is it? When we talk about systematic racism, from policing to education, healthcare, housing, the opposition, they say, no way in Vermont, progressive Vermont, we have it. When we talk about issues in school that we are not teaching, everything actually, and I am a public school completely, you know, but look at the what they teach our children in school. History, math, social study, music, everything is white, European background, colonialist mentality. But in everything we can tell you, never succeeded on this country without us, the ethnic groups, we came from somewhere else. And you are trying here to protect yourself with the mentality of colonialist majority. And now you are ruling us by fear that if the Latinos come over here, what will happen to us? So they are what now? They are smugglers. Your media and education about the blacks is what? They are a criminal enterprise. The Arabs, what are they on your? They are terrorists, you know? This is completely fake. This is the fake thing about the history of this country. Without those groups, including, and I will never forget, the indigenous people of this land, the natives, you will never survive. And for the future, this is the beginning. The ethnic group study is just the beginning. And if you are true to yourself, you have to stand with us now, because we don't want to wait another 50 years to come and say education is very important for our kids. If they are ethnic groups or white, let's teach our white students the truth about this country for a change.
There's a fear of, there was a lot of the conversation was that we need to be more inclusive. We weren't inclusive enough because we weren't including the white males, for example. It was true, it was a conversation that we needed to have them, everybody needed to be able to, including people from European descent, including males, because we didn't want to be anybody else. That was, so, you know, there's that fear of why are you separating us? Why do you need to have your own space in a way, which is not what we're trying to do. We're just trying to become visible and stop being excluded.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Paula Johnson Kurtz and I'm from Montpelier, and also I'm somebody who went away, grew up in Vermont schools, went away and came back and planned to be here. So I was new, but and I just wanted to share a brief experience from going through schools here about my English education and having
read through 4 years of high school, only 5 books out of 40 by women or people of color. And that's the distribution of, and the rest were all by men. And so we're expected to read this canon that's just a false narrative about who's created and who has put work out into the world and about what's important. So I just want to echo what everyone has said about this bill being important based on that. And thank you for sharing your stories. My question is just around funding, and I'm glad that you touched on Arkaya, but I'm curious what the bill, like what the pathway forward looks like. What are the funding needs to make this successful? And then also, if this bill is funded with only a $50 stipend for reimbursements for trap, what? You know, if that's the funding mechanism that's in place right now, like what does, if we don't get federal funding, what does it look like? Are we looking at a new bill next session that provides more funding for this? And what's the momentum that's needed to ensure that is funded?
So the stipend as it's written within the bill, that's kind of standard operating for all panels and commissions in this state. Unfortunately, that's kind of how we value. It's the value we place on community engagement. That was a critique. So it's going to take public private partnership. I'm going to be honest. If you want to know what's going to take, what number would you like to see? What number would you like to see? And that's what we need to get. We have seen some really innovative projects. I'm putting the call out. I'm throwing down the gauntlet, especially to higher education, who has a vested interest in this. I'm putting it out to the private sector. There are organizations, businesses that should have a very strong vested interest in wanting to see this type of work be very successful. It's going to take more than what we can make happen here. We know that our funds are held hostage in this building for all sorts of needs that need to happen. And I do understand as well that money is tight everywhere, but these are the types of long-range investments that have to be paid. There's no other way around it. So we need to shake every tree. So we'll shake the federal tree, we'll shake your local tree, we'll shake them all in order to get what's needed.
I do want to say that the Agency of Education was attempting to enter more money, to look for other funds to hire a person that can coordinate the efforts. So Amy was trying to move us around, but there was no money to be found. So.
Hi, I'm Laura, also Sarah's babysitter for her children sometimes. And in terms of money, if it's going to lead towards seeking, heading towards the private sector, who would you guys recommend would be the best place for community members to put their money and give a donation?
So I think because we are in this stage of the process, I want to just sign up to our list, and then once we formulate what that will look like, we have a steering committee of a lot of members that, and we have campaign partners. Once the bill passes, then we're going to shift our gear into thinking, okay, how can we make this very, very good? Like, we need to make sure that, one, we need to choose the people that are going to be in the committee, which we are hoping is going to be a community effort. The reason why we were pushing that we were the ones picking our 8 members was because we want to make sure that they represent the communities they say they're representing and that they're advocates, because I could represent the Latino community, the Latinx community, but maybe not know anything about the history or the politics around it. So that's why we want to make sure that whoever represents really has, you know, the ethical advocacy of it. So we will then formulate what that looks like, how much money we will need. Right now, if you want to support, go to our website. There's a lot of organizations that are in the community that are doing some of the work, like Shahan, the NWCP, Vermonters from Palestine that are doing work. Rachel is here with Justice a stand-up for social justice in Hartwick. So there's a lot of voices for vulnerable children, people that are on the ground doing their work. But we will call on you when we have a budget for what that is going, what's going to take on this.
I just wanted to speak on that. This is of utmost importance, especially at this time. And I'm Rachel Wilson, by the way, from Stand Up. You know, I just want to speak on how important this is going to be for the success of our students who come from communities that have been marginalized, how important it's going to be for their self-esteem. I can speak for myself. I didn't grow up in Vermont, but I grew up in New England, and I was so afraid to try new things. I was so afraid to throw myself out there and really be a leader and do the things that I knew that I could do, because I was so afraid of proving people right if I failed. I was so scared of failing because I thought, if I fail, then they're going to see me as a representative of Black people, of people of color, and then I'm going to prove them right. So I never reached my full potential in school because of that fear. And I know that so many of the students that I'm dealing with, they're going through the same thing. And you know, I have to say, I have not met one student, one child of color, for that matter, one person of color in this state, in this country. I've never met one person who is not dealing with and suffering from trauma around racism. And you know, I wanted to touch a little bit on what Sha'an was saying about people staying here. You know, I am on the ground, I'm doing this work on a constant basis, and you know, this past winter, I had a couple of breakdowns. I have never in my life been so visible, but my experience so invisible. And we all know that racism exists everywhere, all over the country, no matter where you go. But when you're living in a place where there are people who are like you, who look like you, you know that they have shared lived experience, and you can find safety, and you can find commonality. And that's the thing, is like, so many of our students are alone, whether like whatever group they are coming from, they are alone. And that's why this is so important. You know, this is just like, it's about damn time. Come on. It's about damn time.
And we're doing this for the one Black kid in the white school, for the one LGBTQ kid in the other school, because that is what I heard when I came back. Oh, Vermont's so white. Vermont's so white. But even if it's one student, he or she or they count. And that's what we're here, and that's what we're doing this.
And that reminds me of, I wanted to do that at my school, and people will say to me, well, we only have 7 Black students at my school, and I'm like, well, that's more the reason, you know? Like, that's what this bill is, that's what the flag represents. So next year I am teaching a class, a semester-long class, about the history of Black, Latinx, and Indigenous people in the United States, and hearing that the bill doesn't address specifically curriculum, what standards are you guys looking at that's going to like come back to that curriculum in schools? That's my question.
Good question. It's a framework. So the standards are what all the schools have. This is what you have to meet. And then each school district has its own curriculum director, and each teacher has kind of its own discretion. So this is why this is a very small step. So we give the framework, and we also give suggestions as to how those teachers. And I think after this bill passes, and we get funding and do an amazing work, I do this report then, you know, the next step will be to be working school district by school district, because this bill will create a framework and, again, a standards that the state board needs to adopt. The bill doesn't mandate that they do it. We will have to ask them to do that. And then there's so much work. This is just a very small step. If we said teachers, you know, don't tell a teacher that you're doing a curriculum change, because nobody likes that. That's like the one thing. People at the beginning were, we don't support the mandated curriculum. We're like, this is not a curriculum change. This is the standard. So it is important. We cannot do it all at once, so this is the first step. But I think teachers need to work together, and the recruited people that know about these things is really important. Because it's not just recruiting, it's retaining those teachers that can provide that as well.
If you use the same standard, the same books, you will find every story, even including math and music, you don't see anybody but white people created the math. Actually, and I'm proud of it, your algebra and your zero to infinity is an Arab creation. Your computer and algorithm is Arab creation. And Steve Jobs, his Syrian father has. You will find Arabs and Muslims get killed in the Revolutionary War here and their graves in Boston. Do you see that in your curriculum? No. Blacks, Latino, Chicano, all of us, we were, and Native Indigenous definitely, we were part of the beginning to this day of this country. But when you read it and you teach it, it's coming from white European colonialist thinking, and this is going to get rid of it from all your colonialism. We have to be represented on every education aspect on your mother, on the school. We are part of it. Why my children don't see themselves on it? Why we don't see our skin on it, our accent, our names? If they see something like that, they will be feel comfortable. They will feel comfortable, and they, the white person who bullied my daughter, he wouldn't bully her when he knows that she contributed. She's part of this family. We call Vermont, we call America.
I want to make 2 points. Last year, I went to DC for the Women's March, and while we were there, we got to look at some tourist attractions. So we went to the American Smithsonian Museum, which I was pretty reluctant to because I knew that there would be nothing really about people of color. So I went to the very small, isolated section that was meant to talk about Black history, basically, with one other Black student that came with us. And we were walking through this literally one hallway worth of history. And I was naming all the people, and I was oh my God, this person did this, and this person did this, and this person had this hit record, and they started this revolution, and all these things that I knew. And the other Black student that was with me, she turned to me and she was like, Zamora, how do you know all of this? How do you know all this? I don't know any of this. And that just struck me. I realized 2 things. I realized how much our education has been robbed from us, and then also how I had to go out of my way to educate myself. I went to 2 schools. I went to my own institution where I had to teach myself about my own history and the history of other people that weren't white. And then I went to the institution that told me nothing about myself. And it's something else that we need to make clear is that our people of color's history does not start with white people. There's this misconception that we are nothing without you. We don't have a history without you. And it's like, there was a whole history before enslaved African people came to this country. Like, we actually had culture and a society and infrastructure and religion and music and dance, all these beautiful things in every other marginalized community or every other community of color. And also, like, someone else mentioned, I forgot who, but it was like, we need to have a balance also in our curriculum. Like, we need to have a balance of where we're talking about the realness, the truth that isn't whitewashed and doesn't cover the sins of the descendants of Europeans or Euro-Americans. And we also, like we need to actually go into detail about what has actually happened to our communities, the massacres that have happened, the genocides that have happened, the mass rapings that have happened, the assimilation and eugenics practices that have happened, like all these things that we don't ever learn anything about. But we also need to acknowledge that we have done beautiful things, that we have created beautiful music and art, and then we have communities. Like, does anyone even know of, do you know of, like, Black Wall Street? Black Wall Street was literally a booming community of Black folks that had their own infrastructure, their own communities, own businesses. That happened during Jim Crow. Probably, like, most people in this room probably don't even know about that. And it's like, we don't even know about the successes of our people, the beauty that we have created in the face of the most horrible, most frightening things imaginable, in the face of bigotry, in the face of hatred, in the face of genocide. And I think that is empowering for especially students of color to see, like, wow, I can do that too. My people, the people that I'm a descendant of, did that. They created this. Like, we are told and rejected and demeaned and just put down all the time that we feel like we're not capable of anything. And it's like, if we were to actually learn about things like Marvin Gaye or Cesar Chavez or like people of empowerment, like maybe we would actually feel like we are powerful too. Like, there's two sides to every story, and we need to make sure that we paint a whole picture. And the second thing I want to bring up is like the funding part. And I don't know if someone mentioned this before I came or has mentioned this along the way, but it's not just funding this bill. We need to fund to support teachers of color that are already here, because you know that they're being traumatized in the schools that they are currently working in, because they're probably one of few or one of none. And we need to support the students of color that are experiencing psychological and emotional trauma. We need to fund actually having recruiting people to come here and to actually stay here, because quite frankly, I aspire to go out of state for college because I don't want to deal with this anymore. And I shouldn't feel like that. I grew up here. I have a right to be here. And we need to fund actually teaching our white teachers how to talk about these things and how to teach these things. Because I don't care if they're a teacher. That does not mean that they are trained in racial justice. It doesn't mean that they're trained in any of these matters that we're talking about. And it doesn't mean that they actually understand it. You cannot just have someone that's inexperienced, has no basis of knowledge, because they grew up in the same school as we did, okay? They didn't learn any of this. So it's not like they can just go out in the world and teach our kids these things that they know nothing about. So we need to pay for that. We need to pay to actually train our staff and administration. We need to have racial biasing trainings in our schools with the staff, the administrations. I want the bus drivers there, the lunch ladies. I want everybody there, because they have never endured that. And it's like, we cannot just have this assumption, this blanket assumption that, like, oh, we have no bias. We know, we've been educated in these things. Like, I understand race and racism. I understand misogyny and sexism. I understand homophobia and transphobia. No, you don't. Where did you learn it? Did you go out of your way to be educated on these things? You know what I mean? Like, who was there to educate you? So it's like, we need to fund this bill, but after this bill gets passed, we need to fund services that support people of color and other marginalized communities that are already on the ground working this. And we need to recruit people and make sure that those who are teaching these things actually know what they're talking about, so that we're not just perpetuating another cycle of ignorance. And then what's gonna happen is we're gonna get this bill passed, and there's going to be people teaching these things, and then they're gonna say, well, we gave you what you want. Well, yeah, you gave us what we want, but do you actually know what you're talking about? What are you teaching our kids? Are you reaffirming biases? Are you reaffirming white supremacy? Are you reaffirming these systems of oppression? Yeah.
Thank you, Sandy. Anybody else want to share questions?
No, man. I don't know if we want to take up too much space. I wanted to try to talk directly for a second to like the legislators here and people on the community stuff. Just a quick experience. So I have the honor to work with Rachel in the schools over in Hardwick. histories. We've got no understanding of the opportunities and times in our history where poor people had a chance to build and survive and were cleft apart by the invention of race and the insistence of racist institutions running the day by rich people throughout. And so it just, hurt people. Hatred comes only from fear and misunderstanding, and I see that every single week in these schools although the absolute pain and misery of racist institutions and racist experiences are borne by people of color, we all are limited incredibly by a white supremacist society and living in it, and I see it every single day. And speak as someone who grew up in this state, went to these schools and never left, and I'm still here, you know, doing that. So I just wanted to also give that out, but down to a kid-by-kid level there, that the amount of pain and destruction happened in our communities over the void that has been created by not having an ethnic studies bill and purposefulness around understanding our real history is real and significant every day in every school, and I just want to give that little perspective on that.
Real quickly, just as an update, so that you all know within the bill as well, there's provisions looking at restorative practices with regards to incidents. And to bolster this, there's an additional bill that's actually under consideration in judiciary right now on the Senate side, specifically looking at restorative practices in all of our schools. So that's going to be one of the most, I think, a key way of delivering on what you're talking about.
Very much about local control here, so that's why it was important to go after the standards to try to change and look at those standards so that then recommendations around potential items to be used within curriculum can be kind of centralized, but it's a different way that they deal with education there, so I think that's important to know, because when we talk about it, there was resistance, that was part of the piece. We want to keep our local control, and we pretty much shut down the conversations about unfunded mandates because our youth are not unfunded mandates. That's an important piece. But so just to say, I think that's a really, that's a difference on how you're able to build that and sort of compel that change, whereas we have to do it in a much more specific way.
And also the Oregon bill just focused on doing the standards for the social studies. So we went beyond and said everything.
And we included 3K, then just went for the K.
Anybody else? What time is it?
7:45.
Wow. So unless somebody wants to share, Will, do you want to share? No. Well, thank you everybody for coming. I don't know if the panelists would like to add anything. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for all the representatives here. We really appreciate